and we've been doing on FreeBSD. I will start with a brief description of Zen. I know that some of you probably are familiar with Zen, but I guess others are not that familiar, so I will start with a brief description, followed by some notes about how the Zen community works. Then we'll peek into Zen new features. That's mainly the new ARM support and PVH guest. And then we also continue with the recent work that has been doing in FreeBSD. That's mainly the work done on FreeBSD 10 and the work that's ongoing on FreeBSD Head. Then I will do a brief description of the Zen tool stack that's used to manage the hypervisor, and then I will do a demo of FreeBSD 0. So the Zen architecture is quite simple. It's a type 1 hypervisor. We have the hardware on the bottom that contains the devices. And then we have a thin layer that's the Zen hypervisor. It's more or less like a microkernel. And it doesn't use, it doesn't contain drivers for hardware devices. It only manages the CPU, the memory management unit, and the IO MMIU. Everything else, it's passed to the control domain of what we usually call DOM 0, which contains all the hardware devices. This way, we can use hardware drivers from other operating systems, basically, and we don't have to put them inside of Zen. In this case, we can see that the control domain has the hardware drivers, and then I have two other domains next to them. One is a paravirtualized domain that we usually call the PV domain that contains a net front and a block front that's connected to a net back and a block back in the control domain or DOM 0. This is done so that the guest can have access to I/O devices. And then on the other hand, we have a fully virtualized domain that we usually call HVM domain, which in this case, it's not using the paravirtualized devices and it's connected to a device model, that's QEMU, that takes care of emulating the devices for the guest. So that the guest can see a normal, well, the guest feels like it's running inside of a normal computer, basically. If you have questions during the slides, please feel free to ask at any point. So paravirtualization was developed in the late 90s. It was a project done by the Xenoserver research project at Cambridge University, together with Intel and Microsoft. And they realized that x86 instructions behave differently in kernel and user space. So basically, you only have two options for virtualization. You either have to use full software emulation or binary translation. This is a problem because it adds a lot of overhead to emulate to virtualization. So they decide to make a guest aware of virtualization, and they provide a new interface to the guest operating system that had a much lower overhead. And the results of this is what we know today as paravirtualization. I would like to note that this was done in the late 90s, so if it was done today, it will probably be much more different. So they realized that there were a bunch of interfaces that had to be emulated, which added a lot of overhead. So instead of doing this, they decided to paravirtualize them. They paravirtualized the disk and network interfaces, they paravirtualized the interrupts and timers, and they also had to paravirtualize the page tables and the memory management unit, because there was no hardware virtualization at that time. And they also had to use paravirtualization for privileged instructions. On the other hand, full virtualization was introduced to Zen with when the hardware virtualization extensions arrived to CPUs, and basically allows you to run any kind of guest. In order to provide the devices for the guest, the emulated devices, we use QEMU, which is an open source project that has Zen support upstream. And then this also allows us to make use of the nice hardware virtualization extensions like EPT and the AMD equivalent of EPT, basically. And we also allow this kind of guest to make use of PV interfaces if they want to in order to obtain better performance. Here I have a slide about the different virtualization mode that Zen supports. On the bottom we can see PV. And we are using the PV interfaces for everything. We are using PV for disk and network, interrupts and timers are also paravirtualized, the emulated motherboard is also paravirtualized, and the page tables and the privileged instructions are also done using paravirtualization. And on the top, we can see HVM, which is a fully virtualized guest that's using hardware virtualization for the page tables and the privilege instructions, and then is using software virtualization for everything else. This leads to quite poor performance when doing I/O. So we can install PV drivers inside of HVM guest in order to make them perform better when using I/O operations. This is very similar to virt.io, and it allows us to run this guest with much more performance regarding I/O. Then we also have PV-HVM, which is another evolution of HVM, which allows you to use PV drivers for interrupts and timers, and we can remove quite a lot of the overhead there. The only remaining point is that even if you are using PV-HVM, you still need to boot using an emulated BIOS. So it means it's much more slower, and it means we still require a QEMU instance in DOM 0, basically. The Zen community was created on 2003, when Zen was presented in the Symposium of Open Source Operating Systems, I think it was called, and it was released as a GPL2. Then, on 2003, it became a Linux Foundation collaborative project after being worked on during 10 years. The governance of the Zen project is very similar to the Linux kernel. We have several roles, like committers and maintainers. And we also have several sub-projects that are inside of the Zen project itself. We have the Zen and the ARM hypervisor, which are the main projects that share the same code repository. And then we have Zappy, which is a more advanced open source tool stack that use on Zen server. We also have Mirage OS, which is an exokernel that allows you to run applications inside of Zen as virtual machines. And we also have PBOps, which is a project that started, I think it was more or less 4 years ago, and was focused into bringing Zen support into upstream Linux kernels. As of Linux 3.0, all the Zen support for either DOMU or DOM 0 is inside of the Linux kernel, so this project is more or less not doing much things anymore, basically. As said, the roles of the Zen project are very similar to the Linux kernel. We have maintainers who own one or more components inside of the Zen source tree. And then we have committers, which are maintainers that are allowed to commit changes into the Zen code repository. Then we also have the subprojects and teams, which are run by individuals or organizations and are either based on the Zen project or are related to it. You can find more information about the governance of the Zen project in the webpage at the end of the slide. So the Zen Hypervisor is the main project. As I said before, it contains support for running on either x86 or ARM, and is led by 5 committers. 2 are from Citrix, 1 is from SUSE, and the other 2 are independent committers. During the 4.4 release cycle, which is the last release version of Zen, we have commits from 81 individuals from 28 organizations. And the main we have a lot of organizations that contribute to Zen, but the main ones, to name a few, would be Citrix, SUSE, Oracle, Intel, or Amazon, which is using Zen on its cloud. You can also find much more information about all this in the wiki, in the Zen wiki. We have pages that list the different individuals and organizations that have contributed to Zen releases. Any questions? Or so the recent Zen changes mainly include support for running on ARM boards with virtualization extensions. We also added a new mode called PVH, which we'll see in more detail in the following slides. And as usual, we had a bunch of bug fixes and improvements across all components. Zen on ARM started in 2011, and it was focused on bringing Zen into ARM boards with virtualization extensions. There was a project before that that focused on bringing Zen to run into normal ARM boards without virtualization extensions, but it was never merged back into the Zen source tree, so it was abandoned at some point. If you want to run Zen on ARM, you need one board with virtualization extensions. That should be either a Cortex A7 or a Cortex A15. And the recommended release is the last release, which is Zen 4.4. We also have support for 64 ARM chips, but I think there are not many out there in the market, so it's actually quite hard to try to find one of them. I don't work with the Xenon ARM project, so I don't know much about its internals, but you can find much more info in the web page at the bottom of the slide. And if you want, you can also ask questions on ZenDevel or the other Zen mailing list. Then on the 4.4 release, we added a new virtualization mode that's called PVH. And it's very similar to PVHVM. It's mainly a PV guest inside of an HVM container. We believe that this mode will bring the best performance because it takes the best parts from both HVM and PV guest. Basically, you don't need any kind of emulated devices. And the guest has a hardware emulated MMIU, which means that you don't need to use the PV interface for managing page tables. And also the guest has access to the same protections levels as you will find on bare metal. It was originally written by Mukesh Rathod at Oracle, but significant revisions was done by George Dunlap in order to upstream it into the Zen source tree. So now I've extended the virtualization spectrum and I've added PVH. As you can see, it's another evolution of PVHVM, basically, and we are using the PV interfaces for the emulated motherboard, which means that we are using PV when we boot. We don't need any kind of emulated BIOS or anything like that. So PVH, as said, runs inside of an HVM container. It doesn't require the PV MMIU code, which is very intrusive. The Linux kernel maintainers always complain about the PV MMIU stuff because it's very, very intrusive. And it also allows the kernel to run with normal privilege levels because we are using virtualization extensions on the CPU. So everything related to the CPU and the memory management unit, it's virtualized by hardware. We also disable all the emulated devices, the ones that are emulated by QEMU or the ones that are emulated inside of Zen, like the local APIC or the IO APIC are disabled, so the guest doesn't have access to any of them and has to use the PV path. We also have to use the PV path for vCPU bring up. This means that when we want to bring secondary processors, we don't take the normal, what you would do on bare metal, basically. Oh, sorry. And then it's much more simple, actually, because the way secondary CPUs are brought up on Zen is much more simple. You just have to use an hypercall, so it's actually quite better than doing it the bare metal way, basically. We also have to use PV hypercalls for a bunch of stuff, like fetching the memory map from Zen, because we have no emulated BIOS, so we have to fetch the memory map from Zen itself. And then it uses the PVHVM callback mechanism in order to get interrupts from Zen. We'll see more about this mechanism in later slides. So the difference with PV is that on PVH, the page tables are in control by guest. You can do whatever you want with the page tables, and you don't have to use any kind of PV operations to manage them. The interrupt descriptor table is also in full control of the guest because it's virtualized by hardware. And you no longer have the difference between a PFN and an MFN. Previously on PV guest, there was a difference between memory addresses because you were actually seeing the real memory address behind it. So we had some kind of three-level translation inside of guest, which was quite intrusive. And we also able to use the native syscall and sysenter. We have no kind of specific Zen callbacks like the event or failsafe callbacks. And the guest is able to run with the guest is able to manipulate the I/O privilege levels. The difference with PVHVM is that since we no longer have a BIOS, we need to add ELF nodes to the Zen kernel. This is done so that, we need to add ELF nodes to the FreeBSD kernel. This is done so that Zen knows where to load the kernel and how to jump into it. We also boot with paging enabled, which means that it's much faster than booting through a BIOS. And there are also slightly differences in the way we set up Grand Table and Zen Store, but it's very minimal changes. And finally, we have no emulated devices, so we are not able to use the local IPIC or any kind of HP tamers or anything like that. Now I would like to speak a little bit about the Zen support in FreeBSD 9. on FreeBSD 9, you were either able, you could run FreeBSD as a PB guest on 32-bit, but you were limited to only one vCPU. We didn't have support for SMP. Or you could also run in Zen as an HBM guest with PB drivers. This is for both 32 and 64 bits. This means that we already had Zen Store and Grand Table implementations. We already have event channel support inside of FreeBSD. We had support for PB disk and PB network interfaces, and we also had implemented the suspend and resume code inside of FreeBSD in order to migrate the guest from different hosts. Then on FreeBSD 10, we added PB HBM support, which means that we had to add support for the vector callback. As said, we'll see that in the following slide, exactly what the vector callback means. We unified the event channel code with the PB port. This means that we had less code duplication inside of FreeBSD. And we also implemented PB timers and PB APIs. This was done in order to reduce the overhead of emulation. And finally, we had to implement the PB suspend and resume protocol in order to re-enable the PB timers and the PB APIs. Here I have a description of, tries to be a description of what the vector callback is. On previous FreeBSD versions, we were using a PC interrupt in order to get events from Zen. This means that the interrupt was global to the operating system. We could not inject interrupts into specific CPUs. We were just injecting a PC interrupt that could be delivered to any CPU. And in fact, Zen would inject an interrupt that was received by the Zen PC driver. Then this driver will deliver the interrupt to the event channel of call. And finally, this interrupt will be delivered to the PB disk or PB NIC interfaces. On FreeBSD 10, we added support for the vector callback, which means that we have an IDT vector that allows us to deliver interrupts to different vCPUs. Then when Zen injects an interrupt, this interrupt is delivered to the event channel opcall code directly, and we can inject this to either PB disk or PB NICs, as it was on previous FreeBSD versions, but we can also use that to inject interrupts for PB timers and PB APIs. So the PB timer is implemented using hypercalls, PB hypercalls, and we are implementing an event timer using the set single shot timer hypercall, which allows us to get interrupts from Zen at specific intervals. We also provide a time counter using the information that's shared by Zen in the vCPU time infrastructure. And we also provide a wall clock using the same information that's used by the time counter. This allows us to fulfill all FreeBSD timer needs using PB interfaces, so we don't need any emulated devices. The PB IPs are interesting because usually on bare metal, we use the local APIC to inject and receive the APIs from other CPUs. Since now we can inject event channels into specific vCPUs, this means that we no longer need the local APIC. We can use the event channels in order to inject APIs into vCPUs, and it removes the overhead of using the local APIC. This means that we have to take less VM exits, basically, because we don't have to read or write on the local APIC. In order to allow the PB HBM guest to do suspend and resume so it can do migration, we need to rebind all the API event channels. On resume, we also need to rebind all the BIRQ event channels used for the PB timers. And we finally need to reinitialize the timer on each vCPU. This is done automatically by the suspend and resume code. And finally, we need to reconnect the front ends, the PB disk and the PB NICs that we were doing on FreeBSD 10. This has not changed. So we are also working on head right now in order to import PBH, DOM-U, and DOM-0.
So can you go back to the timers for a second? Yeah. Any need for a VM exit in programming a timer?
If you use the local APIC for the timer, yes, then you have to take VM exits because you are writing and reading from the local APIC. Okay. It depends, and if you are using HPET or something like that, then yeah, it's also emulated, so you need to take VM exits basically. I mean, when we use hypercalls, we also take VM exits because we have to call back into Zen, but we only do one of them. If you read and write from the local APIC, it means that you actually do more VM exits, basically. So we are basically working now on getting PBH support into FreeBSD head, both DOM 0 and DOM U. Since PBH is based on PBH VM and it's quite similar, the work required in order to have PBH is not that much. What we need to do for DOM U was to add the PB entry point into the kernel. This is a different entry point than the native one. And we have to wire this entry point into the FreeBSD boot sequence. This was actually quite easy because since we have a hardware virtualized memory management unit, we don't need to do any kind of PB specific page table setup or anything like that. So it's actually quite easy. We also have to fetch the memory map from Xen. As I said before, we have no emulated BIOS, so the memory map is provided by Xen using an hypercall. We also have to use the PB console because we have no emulated serial. And we have to get rid of the usage of any emulated devices in FreeBSD early boot. For example, FreeBSD, I think, was using the LAPIC timer very early on boot before searching for other timers. It was used unconditionally, so we had to remove that and instead use the PB timer. It was the the timer used was the E8254, I think, that's used on early boot, always. Mm. Yeah.
Calibrate the
TSC,
yes.
Yeah. So we had to remove that and use the PB timer, basically. You had another question? Yeah. And then we also have to use the PB path in order to bring up secondary CPUs, which is quite easy. It's much more easy than when you do it on bare metal, from my point of view. And finally, it's also important to notice that all the hardware description comes from Xen Store, because on PB we don't have any kind of emulated, we don't pass any kind of ACP tables into the guest, so all the hardware description comes from Xen Store. PB DOM 0 builds on top of PB DOM U, basically, and it's very similar to PB DOM U. The main difference is that on DOM 0 we actually have access to physical hardware. So Xen has to parse the ACP tables, FreeBSD has to parse the ACP tables and notify Xen about the devices it's found. This is done because Xen has no ACP parser, basically, because it's a very big piece of code, it's very intrusive, and we don't want to put it in Xen. So we did this kind of hack, it's done since PB, that the guest is in charge of parsing the ACP tables and notifying Xen about the devices it finds. And basically, we also had to add a couple of user space devices in order to interact with Xen. That's done so the tool stack can interact with Xen and it can create guests and things like that. This is an architectural overview of the resulting work that has been going on in head. Basically, we added a Xen specific nexus that depends on the event channel implementation, and then we put all the PB devices inside of what we call the Xen PB bus. This is done so we can have a more contained way of attaching the PB devices. They are no longer attached directly into the Nexus. They have their own bus. And the most interesting devices here are probably Xen Store, which takes care of getting the hardware description from Xen. We also have the grand table that's used to share memory with DOM 0 or any other domain in the host. We also have the PB timer and the PB console. And we can see that from Xen Store we have several devices that hang off it. We have the PBD, we have PB disk, PB NIC, and one we call the control interface. The control interface is used by DOM 0 to send signals to the guest. For example, shutdown. You write something to Xen Store and then the guest using the control interface realizes that Xen is actually asking the guest to shut down. So we shut down the guest, basically. And then we have the two user space devices used to manage Xen. One is PriefCMD, which is used by the toolstack to issue hypercalls into Xen and to map memory from foreign domains. And we also have the event channel, which is used to register and receive interrupts from Xen by user space devices. I think I've explained both devices, so I will skip this slide. Now I would like to explain a little bit more about the toolstack. In Xen, we used to have two different toolstacks in the past. One was called XM and the other one was called XL. XM has been deprecated for several releases and has been finally removed in what's now the current Xen repository, and it basically is the next Xen release will ship without XM. So now it means that XL is the only tool stack inside of Xen, and it's built on top of libXL, usually called libXenLite. That is a library to interact with the hypervisor. The main features of libXL is that it provides a stable API, so you can actually use it, that in your applications, and you don't have to really care what's the underlying version of libXL, because the API is stable. It's also code in C, that quite different from XM, which was code in Python. It added a lot of overhead to the tool stack. Now it's much more smaller and it consumes much less memory. And also I would like to notice that we have a libvirt driver built on top of libXL. So you can actually use all the nice features from libvirt, like birds. We can also integrate with OpenStack or CloudStack using this libvirt driver. XL is the default tool stack. It's a small command line utility. It's very simple, in fact. And configurations for VMs are stored as plain text files. We'll see an example of one configuration later. And XL provides a set of commands to manage the hypervisor, but it's not going to do anything fancy for you. It's not going to set up your network or your storage. It's very simple. So if you are searching for someone more advanced that is able to take snapshots or to move your storage around or things like that, you will have to look at a higher level tool stack like libvirt, CloudStack, or OpenStack. Here I have an example configuration file of XL. In this case, this is a Linux PV domain. We can see that we are giving Xen the kernel and the RAM disk that it has to use. We are also setting the command line arguments that we are going to append to the kernel. Basically, we are telling Linux that this is the RAD partition. We are also assigning 4 vCPUs to the domain and 2 gigabytes of memory. The name of the domain is going to be test. And then we are attaching one PV network interface that's going to be attached to bridge zero. And then we are also attaching one disk to the guest. In this case, is a raw file, basically. I think I will go for the conclusions and do the demo after, so we can ask questions while we are doing the demo. There are still some items that are pending inside of FreeBSD in order to get good Xen support. Mainly, we are missing multi-boot support in the FreeBSD bootloader. This is needed in order to boot Xen as DOM 0. So we'll have to look into adding multi-boot support. We also have to improve the performance and compatibility of our network of NetFront, which is the PVNIC interface, and we also probably need to look into improving the performance of NetBack. And we are also missing some user space devices to interact with Xen. These are actually not that important, are used by some functions, but you can run a DOM 0 without them. We are missing what we call the GNT dev that allows user space applications to map grant frames. And we are also missing the GNT alloc, which allows user space applications to share their memory with other domains. The patches have been published and are available on my Git repository. You can find them there. And there are also some patches for the tools, for the Xen tools. I think half of them have already been committed to Xen upstream, so there's not much work remaining there. I also have a couple of patches for QEMU and one patch for CBIOS that has already been committed. And I think one of the QEMU patches have actually been committed also to the repository. So we see how the FreeBSD Xen support has evolved from HVM to PVHVM and finally to PVH. FreeBSD DOM 0 support is quite close. We are getting there. And this means that you can actually use FreeBSD as a full-feature virtualization solution using Xen. Now I will go for the demo. If you have some questions now or... Here I have my console. It's actually very small. It's actually waiting on the Pixi Linux bootloader. Now I'm going to launch Xen and the FreeBSD DOM 0. Now it's loading the FreeBSD kernel. This is Zen booting. And now we jump into the FreeBSD kernel. Now the FreeBSD kernel is scrubbing memory, and now it's booting. Any questions? Yeah? Multiboot is a specification about how you boot kernels. So we have to actually implement that in the FreeBSD bootloader. This is needed so that you can boot Zen. Well, you can boot Zen and then you can pass Zen the FreeBSD kernel and the FreeBSD metaloader information. We can do that with Pixie Linux, but it's kind of ugly. I mean, we need to add proper support to the FreeBSD bootloader. Oh, now it's booted. I'm gonna connect to it. You can see that it's a FreeBSD host. Now I'm using Excel to list the domains. Sorry, I'm gonna make this a little bit bigger, actually. Yeah, so now we can see that Zen only has one domain, which is the DOM0, which has 2 GB of RAM. This box actually has 8 GB of RAM, but I've only assigned 2 GB to the DOM0. And it has also only 2 vCPUs assigned, and I think this box has 8 vCPUs. So now I will launch a Debian PB DOMU. This is what we call PyGrab, which basically searches the image for kernels, and now it's booting the kernel. Oh, sorry, I have to initialize the bridge. And this is a Linux PB DOMU booting. And now we have the domain available. I'm gonna, for example, start a kernel build inside of this domain. Now I'm gonna go back to the DOM0. I'm basically detaching from the DOMU console. Now I'm again in the DOM0. Now if we look at the list of domains, we can see that we have DOM0 running and we also have the Debian domain running. If I use, for example, XLTop, we'll be able to see the CPU usage of the 2 different domains. We can see that the Debian domain, of course, is running a kernel build, so it's actually using much more CPU than the DOMU. Then I can also create a FreeBSD DOMU. In this case, this is a PBHBM DOMU. I have configured the serial console, so we'll actually see output here of the FreeBSD bootloader. I don't know if you want to ask anything. I mean, it's not that interesting to see VMs booting. I mean, it's not that new anymore. Maybe 10 years ago it was interesting, but right now.
Do you already provide Virt.io support to guests?
No. The problem with Virt.io is that it's designed with the premise that the host is always able to access guest memory. That's not true on Zen, because on Zen we don't pass memory around. We pass what we call grand table entries, which means that It's actually a little bit hard to get virtio working. We could get it working at some point, but we'll have to change the virtio specification in order to allow using grand frames instead of memory addresses directly. On Zen, the main thing is that the DOM0 is just another guest. That's different from either KVM or Beehive, where the host has actually access to all memory.
You know, when you install FreeBSD 10 now, for example, in Zen, which, you know, the default, which kind of emulation are you going to end up with?
The better one that Zen could provide. It depends on the Zen version that you're running. If you're running Zen prior to 4.0, you will get HVM with PB drivers, because that's the only thing that's available. If you're running anything newer than Zen 4.0, you will get PB HVM by default. It's all merged inside of the generic kernel, so you don't have to compile a specific kernel or anything like that. I think I have, yeah, I'm gonna set this VM to also do kernel build. Now I'm gonna detach from that VM. And again, we can see that we have the two VMs that are actually much more busy than the DOM0. The DOM0 is mainly only doing I/O on behalf of the VMs. It's using blockback and, well, in this case only blockback, because we are not using network here. And then, for example, I can shut down both guests. The Debian VM has already shut down. Now we are waiting for the FreeBSD one. And now both VMs are gone. We can see on the list that there's no longer a VM. And finally, I will launch an OpenBSD VM. This one doesn't have PB drivers, and I haven't configured the serial console, so we are going to attach to it using the BNC viewer, well, using a BNC connection. And we can see here OpenBSD booting inside of an HVM container, basically. This is using all the emulated devices from QEMU. Yeah?
Can you explain what you mean by software virtualization versus hardware virtualization?
Hardware virtualization is provided by the CPU. It's actually inside of, it's using the Intel, BMX, and things like that. Software virtualization is done by QEMU or by Zen, basically. Well, and now we have the OpenBSD VM booted. We can ping Google, for example. So, well, if there are no more questions. I'm gonna destroy the VM. And it's gone. So, yeah?
How many virtual machines do you expect to be able to put up on, say,
It depends on the memory you have. The only restriction on Zen is that you cannot page out memory inside of Zen. So if you have 8 GB of memory and want to create, one gigabyte guest, you will probably only be able to create 6 or 7 of them, depending on the memory that you assign to DOM0. Then there's no limit on the scheduler or anything like that. So if you have very small VMs, I think that recently they pushed the limit quite high and someone was able to get 2,000 VMs running on a host. This was a Linux host, of course, but it probably applies to FreeBSD also. Well, they were very, very small VMs with, I think, 32 megabytes of RAM only. Thank you for your attention then.